Hey folks, this is Ignacio with North Star Senior Advisors. Thank you for joining me today. Really quick about us, we're a senior placement company and geriatric care management service here in Central Florida. We've been in business about 6 years now. We offer complimentary service with senior placement to help seniors and families locate assisted living and memory care options. And we now have geriatric care management services as well under North Star Cares. Today I have the pleasure of joining me, Joanny Rodriguez. How are you?
Hi there, doing well. Thanks for having me.
Great, good. Nice to meet you. Today's topic, folks, is going to be the veteran benefit called aid in attendance. This is a great topic. Me being a veteran myself, I come across a lot of veterans that we help and families, and it's a really good benefit to could potentially help assist through some costs, right, with assisted living. So I'm going to go ahead and let you, Joanny, introduce yourself.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Hi again. My name is Joanny Rodriguez, and I am the Medicaid Managing Attorney at Family First Firm. I also do asset protection and qualification for long-term care benefits, including the VA. Happy belated Veterans Day to you, Ignacio, and to all the veterans watching. Thank you so much for your service. Just to tell you a little bit about aid in attendance, it is a very special program, and it's known as a pension improvement benefit, which means that the VA is not giving money for, you know, service-connected disability or as a part of a retirement package. So even though it's called pension, it's actually a pension improvement benefit, which is needs-based and also looks at countable family income and net worth limits. One of the really important things to know about the aid in attendance pension is that they want to help offset unreimbursed medical expenses. So in order to qualify for this program, the veteran or the surviving spouse of a veteran must be incurring some kind of unreimbursed medical expense.
Okay, got it. So with that said, and that's a great opening into the benefit, what would you say it's maybe some additional general criteria when it comes to time in service, age, etc.?
Absolutely. So great point. One of the biggest requirements is that the veteran must have served at least one day of active duty during a 90-day enlistment, which fell during a war period. Mm-hmm. So the VA website and our materials, if you have any questions about whether or not your dates of service actually qualify, those dates are published in various places. But it is an active duty wartime period. You do not have to be boots on the ground. And that's a really important distinction. So if you were active duty during Vietnam War, but you weren't actually serving in Vietnam, that doesn't mean that you will not qualify for the benefit. So no boots on the ground requirements, just an active duty during a 90-day enlistment, one day of which fell during a war period. In addition, the individual must be over the age of 65, and then there are the income and asset criteria, which we can go into a little bit more detail about later.
Okay, excellent. Another quick question. I know working with a lot of seniors that are veterans and families, sometimes they assume this could be like an automatic benefit if they just call the VA, but you know, this is something that has to be applied for. There is a process, correct?
Absolutely, yes. There is an application process. And it can be quite complicated depending on whether or not you have access to your DD-214 or discharge papers, whether we have access to the veteran's social security number, date of birth. A lot of those records were lost or destroyed in a fire that happened in the Veterans Administration. And so that can be the biggest delay, is actually getting the supporting documentation that's necessary for the application. But it is an ongoing process. One of the really good things to know about the benefit is that there is a back pay component. So as long as you file an intent to file, that freezes the date of retro eligibility. And then we can get back pay benefits up to that intent to file date. So even if you're not sure if you qualify or you're not sure what's required to qualify, schedule an appointment with an attorney, let us do a full assessment and evaluation. And at a minimum, we'll get that intent to file submitted so that we can preserve that retroactive date.
Yeah, and that's a great point. I'm glad you verified that. I know a lot of times families, seniors may, as they go into assisted living memory care specifically, they may have to tap into savings. They may have to be some family contributions. So know that that is a possibility where they can get that retro benefit. It's a sigh of relief. They can replenish their savings when that time comes. So that's a really good thing. So when we look at this benefit, Johnny, and how to apply, so I would think the clinical element may be a criteria, but there's also financial, and I think there's even a look back period. Is that correct?
Yes. So let's talk a little bit about that look back period for just a minute. It's very, very important. And a lot of our clients don't understand what the look back means, what it implies. And so basically, when you submit an application for an attendance pension to the Veterans Affairs, they will do a search into the applicant's assets. And they are allowed to look back 3 years from the date of application to see whether or not the veteran or the spouse or a family member in the household has intentionally transferred assets for the purpose of eligibility. And the truth of it is, that some transfers don't look intentional, or when we make the transfers, it's not for the purpose of eligibility. I've had issues with large wedding presents, large graduation presents to a grandchild graduating from college or graduate school, or even a loved one who helped make a deposit on a grandchild's first home purchase. Those aren't done for the purpose of Medicaid eligibility or VA eligibility, but they come up in that look back phase. And we have to deal with them, because if we can't cure the transfer, there's a penalty period that's imposed, which means you may qualify today based on the criteria, but if that transfer occurred in that 3-year window, they will impose a penalty moving forward. So let's say 3 or 4 months that you're otherwise eligible, that the VA will not pay benefits until that penalty period has run. So where we're concerned about every penny and the cost of long-term care, that 3-year look back can really be problematic. And just so you know, it can be cured. So if there's a transfer for less than fair market value, which is the exact terminology that they use, we can cure it, we can fix it, but we have to know about it. So just be sure to be transparent with whoever you use as your financial planner and the attorney that you use for long-term care benefits eligibility.
Okay, great. That's good to know. And when it comes to the actual amounts, I believe that this could be also for spouses, correct? So if you're the actual veteran like myself, and then if my wife needed this benefit, it's for both the veteran and spouse. Is that correct?
So for the most part, that's correct. What I will say is this. It's really designed for the veteran or the surviving spouse of the veteran.
Gotcha.
And so while the veteran is alive, if the spouse is the one who's requiring care, there are other benefits that can be obtained, such as homebound, which is very similar to aid in attendance. But aid in attendance itself is technically reserved for the veteran who needs long-term care or the surviving spouse of the veteran who needs long-term care.
Okay, excellent. Thank you for clarifying that. That's good to know. And when it comes to amounts, what are some numbers for folks that are watching for them to keep in mind that could be benefit here with this pension plan?
Sure. So let's talk about the asset limit first.
Okay.
That is a hard limit of $128,000 to $129,000. There's a few $100 range there that can be forgiven, if you will. But say max $129,000. And what's interesting about the way the VA calculates the asset limit is they also look at your gross income into that total. So let's say there's a couple who has $30,000 a year of income, then in fact, they can only have $99,000 in assets, right? Because the gross annual income is factored into that net worth limit. What is good to know is that the homestead is exempt. So if you have a primary residence, that property is not going to be countable towards your net worth limit. And for most seniors, their home is their most expensive asset. So anything above $129,000 is typically where an attorney is involved in order to help qualify and shelter the assets that need to be sheltered. But the maximum annual pension rate, so that you're aware of some of these numbers, is as follows. If it's just the surviving spouse of the veteran, the maximum that they could receive a month in aid in attendance pension would be $1,228 a month. Now, that's not guaranteed. There's a whole analysis about income received and how much of that income is spent on an unreimbursed medical expense. Mm-hmm. But if you can qualify, all of the income is being spent on that care, then you can get a maximum of $1,228. Otherwise, there's a bit of a sliding scale. Okay. For the single veteran who requires care, it can be as much as $1,911 a month. For the married veteran who has a dependent spouse, it can be $2,226 a month. And for two vets who are married and needing care, the two of them, it can be $3,032 a month. What's really exciting about this benefit is the fact that the entire assisted living bill counts as an unreimbursed medical expense. So for those folks who are on the fence about whether or not now is the appropriate time in their care continuum to transition to an assisted living facility, sometimes knowing that there's this financial benefit that's going to help cover the cost of that burden is the decision-making point, right? It's what pushes us across that bridge of indecision, which is often controlled by emotions and uncertainty. So just keep that in mind, that if you can qualify for this benefit, the financial relief that it provides can be pretty significant.
Yeah, no, this is great for sure. And I know these amounts that you shared with us, you know, for the most part, will cover at least 50% at times, if not a little bit more, depending on how much care they need in assisted living or memory care. So this could be a tremendous help. Now, once approved, can they ever lose the benefit? You mind going into that a little bit?
Yeah, so that's a great point. And I will tell you that the law in this area is changing constantly. Yeah. So something that I say today or that we talk about today, in all actuality, could change in the future. This is an area that's highly legislated. Laws are constantly being changed. But from the time that you apply, the rules that existed at the time of application are the rules that control. So the sooner we get these pending applications in for people who are concerned about eligibility, the better, because it's going to be assessed in accordance with the rules at this time. Any rule changes that take place in the future take place for the future applicants, not any retroactively.
Okay.
So I thought that was important for you to know. In terms of what can change, is that the question? Sorry, could you repeat that?
Yeah, no. So let's say they got the benefit, right? They've moved into an assisted living. Okay. They're capturing that benefit. Fast forward, let's say, you know, 2-3 years. Is there anything that can happen in that dynamic where they could lose the benefit, let's say?
Yes. So let's say, God forbid, a spouse should pass, and now our cost of care is lower. Granted, our income is lower, but there could be a shift in benefits at that point. Okay. There's also the possibility of losing benefits if our assets increase rapidly. So typically how that could happen is if we come across an inheritance, or if we sell the homestead, which was previously an exempt asset, that can also cause eligibility issues.
Okay.
So we need to be keeping in mind, what are the asset levels? What are the income levels? What is the unreimbursed medical expense, and how is the VA going to look at that as a whole? So we need to make sure that you're informing the attorney who's done your application of any significant changes as well, so that we can be proactive about that.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense, and thank you for sharing that with the folks watching. So it sounds like it's just a really good idea to get with your attorney and really figure this out, not just now, but in the future potentially, so you have that long-term look on the benefit. For those that are watching, they've heard that amount. What was it,
$129,000.
Okay. If they're watching that, they say, okay, well, I'm over that. I'm not going to be able to apply for that or benefit from that. Should they still give you guys a shot and see if there's ways that things can be worked out?
Definitely. That is a huge reason why I exist. That's a big reason why elder law and asset protection and long-term care planning for government benefits is a niche practice that I participate in, that I like to think I'm becoming an expert in. I've been practicing in this space for a little over 6 years. And the firm that I'm with now has been in existence for a little over 10. And this is all that we focus on, is elder law, whether that's guardianship, estate planning, advanced directives, Medicaid, and VA. We focus on these, our clients' needs, and especially in this demographic. So just make sure that whatever expert you rely on for guidance is licensed and credentialed and regulated. Our office is filled with accredited agents through the VA, and we have malpractice insurance, and we're also controlled by the Florida Bar. So there are a lot of non-attorney planners out there who may sound more attractive for various reasons, whether it's competitive fees or what they promise. But just be mindful that if, God forbid, something should happen with that planner or that advisor, you have no recourse. There's no malpractice insurance. There's no bar to file a complaint with. And so that's why us attorneys like to pride ourselves on the fact that we can be held accountable. And if there's something that should happen, you know, you have a form of recourse with a non-attorney planner who's really engaged in the unlicensed practice of law. You don't have that. So just keep that in mind to make sure you're working with a credentialed and well-reputed expert.
Yeah, no, that's a great point, especially if people are looking at all their options. It's important for them to know what's credible, do their homework. So that's great. I appreciate that. So folks, you have Joanie's information here as you're watching. You have her office number. You have their website, Family First Firm. We worked with them closely for years here in Central Florida. We trust them. We work and send clients their way. We trust them. So feel free to give Joanie a call, visit their website. If you have any questions about the VA aid in attendance benefit, it's a lot more involved than just a simple conversation. So if you think you can benefit from this, I would give them a call and set up a consultation.
Excellent. Definitely. We offer free consultations for anybody coming in about these long-term care benefits. So don't hesitate to take advantage of that opportunity. And one last thing I would add is the VA benefits are a great pairing with Medicaid benefits. So you can actually have both benefits at the same time. So I just wanted to lay that groundwork maybe for another follow-up conversation about Medicaid benefits and how those are available. Not all facilities contract with Medicaid providers, which can be a challenge. But for those that do, you can have both Medicaid and VA at the assisted living level. So we are happy to help and be here for you in any way that we can. Don't hesitate to pick up the phone and give us a call. It's a free consultation.
There you go, folks. You have nothing to lose. So give them a call, get more information, and we'll have additional topics. So, Johnny, maybe in the future we can go a little bit deeper on the Medicaid side and you know, provide some additional educational pieces for the families that are watching. So,
Be my pleasure.
Yeah. So thank you for taking the time, folks. Hopefully you find this helpful. And again, if you need anything, feel free to reach out to Family First Firm and they'll be more glad to assist. So Joanie, thank you for taking the time, okay?
Thank you.
All right, take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.